Climate is becoming a hot topic. From cabinet tables to university campuses, more and more people are sitting up and paying attention to how our weather is changing and what impacts those changes are having. The debate has moved on from whether this is happening to how do we stop it. We are feeling the impacts in Ireland through floods and storms, but climate change is hitting the world's poorest the hardest. For the last few years, I've been working in the campaigns team at Trócaire, campaigning for action to tackle climate change. This year, we launched the latest phase of our campaign, the burning question. As a result of climate change, an extra 50 million people could be at risk of hunger by 2050. The burning of fossil fuels such as coal, oil and gas is a major driver of climate change. Fossil fuel companies profit from the destruction of our planet and exert huge political pressure, which is delaying the switch to clean, renewable energy. We are calling on individuals, organizations, and institutions to divest from the fossil fuel industry. By removing investments from fossil fuel companies, we will send a strong message that fossil fuels have no future. Our campaign is part of a wider movement here in Ireland and internationally. I wanted to see firsthand the impacts of climate change in the developing world and to meet some of the communities and activists who are tackling this issue head on. So I decided to head to Malawi, a small landlocked country in Southeast Africa. With a population of over 16 million, Malawi is one of the poorest nations in the world, as well as one of the most vulnerable to climate change. During my trip, I heard how people are trying to adapt as best they can to a changing climate. And I met activists who are leading the fight for climate justice and a sustainable future. And back home, I met with some of the leading activists in Ireland's fossil fuel divestment movement. When we landed in Malawi, I wanted to get an overview of how exactly the country has been affected by climate change. I met with Trócaire's country director, Ethna Brennan, from Waterford, and Heather Masiko, a climate activist working for Malawi's civil society network on climate change. In the past 2 years, the effects of climate change have been compounded by the El Niño weather pattern, a cycle that happens every 2 to 7 years, warming the Pacific Ocean. This has had a knock-on effect on weather patterns around the world. Right now, Malawi and many other countries in southern Africa are facing the worst humanitarian crisis in decades.
Climate change, whether you call it that or not, is top of the agenda here. The weather patterns are top of the agenda, and if you can't grow your small crop, then your livelihood is at risk. Prior to Malawi, I worked in Zimbabwe. I spent 6 years there, and in around 2008, I was very involved in the humanitarian response where over 5 million people required food aid. Now that was the highest that Zimbabwe had ever seen. Zimbabwe that used to be the breadbasket of southern Africa. And from what I'm hearing now, the situation now is as bad, if not worse.
I have grown up in Malawi. I was raised in Malawi. I've done my education in Malawi as well and have been involved in activism for climate change issues as a young person since my days in university. My main concern is seeing that with time there has been that change that is quite noticeable in Malawi related to temperature, related to rainfall.
Over the last 30 years, climate change has driven up temperatures in Malawi. Since 1960, temperatures have risen by 0.9 degrees. By the end of the century, if global greenhouse gas emissions stay the same, Malawi and the rest of southern Africa will face 5 degrees of warming. That is a frightening prospect. Climate change has also brought a change in rainfall patterns, with rains becoming less predictable and more intense. This has led to floods and ruined crops.
The food situation at the moment is not good. We have figures of 2.8 million people needing food aid, but we definitely know that those figures are conservative.
Since we talked to Ethna in April, the number of people needing food aid in Malawi has risen to 8.4 million, and the country has declared a state of emergency. The UN predicts that up to 50 million people in Africa will need food aid by December 2016.
So since last year and this year, we've been concurrently facing dry spells and floods, which are happening probably one after the other.
The floods hit last year. Any of our partners, our beneficiaries who were hit by those floods, potentially, not all of them, but some of them definitely, lost everything.
Last year alone, floods affected a good over half of the country in Malawi, and it washed away most of the crops. Just 2 weeks later, we faced a dry spell. So even if we tried to replant in our gardens, even if we tried to grow more food, it was impossible because we never got the rain back.
I asked Ethna and Heather to take me to some of the communities where they work. I wanted to meet the people on the front lines of the climate crisis and to see for myself the challenges they face. I travelled with Ethna to the village of Kinyera in Dedza, central Malawi. It was a seemingly happy occasion. The villagers were celebrating the opening of a bridge, which had been funded by Trócaire. The bridge would allow for greater access to and from the village across a river. Juliana Lunguzi, a local politician, was also there.
The beauty about this bridge is it links this community to the, you know, to the other side. Just by having that bridge, you're opening up communication, you're opening up a route for them to take their produce down on the other side. So it's a great motivation for them to work hard.
But in the middle of the celebrations, it suddenly struck me. Where was the river?
It's very interesting, like we're just at the end of rainy season now, and it's interesting to see that the main river that we came over to come into the village is dry. And that really shocked me today to see that.
This was a stark indicator of how erratic and extreme weather patterns have become in Malawi. I visited the village of Chilenga in the Salima region of central Malawi. There, Heather introduced me to Grace Diamon, who explained the difficulties of accessing water due to drought. It was alarming to see that the river, which her community depend on for drinking, for washing, for watering their crops, was pretty much dry.
So it's only 5 months out of the 12 months that they can easily access water from this area. In a time when there's no rain, she says that they have to follow the river down the stream so that they should be able to dig like that and get the water. You can imagine for her to fill a bucket, I mean, or to be able to get enough water for her household, that is a lot of work. It's not only her household that is doing this. So her whole village is doing that at this area of the river because of the effects of climate change. Just last week, the water in this river were reaching to up to that height. I could say about 3 meters or so. But then a week after, now we don't even have water in this river because of climate change. We're simply having rain come in at once and then we get some flash floods and all the water goes and they're not really benefiting. And now it's getting worse because at least in the past they could have a very good flow of water over a good period of time, but now they do not have that flow and it is getting worse by year.
The vast majority of families in Malawi are farmers, working on very small pieces of land, usually less than 1 hectare. I wanted to talk to a typical farming family and to find out how they were coping with the changing climate. Back in Kinyera, Ethna introduced me to Stephen and Eliette Muye. Like millions of people across the country, Stephen and Eliette are heavily reliant on the maize crop for their family's survival. Stephen tells me, when the rains are good, we harvest enough maize for the whole year. This year, we will only have enough maize for 3 months. For Stephen, his wife and 4 children, the next few months will be full of uncertainty. He told me, "We have reduced the amount of food we are eating each day. We used to have 3 meals a day, but now we only have 2, one in the morning and one in the evening. We are trying to save the maize we have." Thankfully, this community has received food aid in recent months. The reality is, though, that more will be needed over the year ahead. So far, the situation seemed pretty hopeless. There is no doubt that Malawi faces huge challenges. But during my visit, I met a lot of people whose hope, resilience, and determination in the face of climate change was inspiring. It was fantastic to see the work of the communities I met in Salima, and the obvious pride they took in their efforts to adapt to climate change.
The villagers here have taken an initiative to actually address the problems that are coming because of climate change. And to them, one of the specific initiatives that they took was to conserve their environment, mainly replanting the forests that were long gone in this area. The work that they're doing, it is so interesting to also learn that other community members who were not initially part of the committee have started to join them to be able to support them, for example, in tree planting exercises. As you can see, these are the trees, there's the small trees in between there. These are the ones that they've planted this year.
Myself and Heather talked to Meekness Moffat about the work of the committee.
They're also conducting beekeeping for them to be able to generate income so that they do not go back to utilizing natural resources. So this is the security for the forest. They've got bees inside there and they'll chase everybody who comes and intrudes with the forest. But besides the security, they will get a lot from the honey that is being produced here. One of the things is medicine and the other thing is money. After they've sold the honey, they'll be able to get money and pay for their children's tuition. This male bee does not do anything. So when there's a lot of male bees, it does not help them. So okay, They'll make sure that the workers should chase away the male bees so that they should have more honey. Otherwise, the male bees in here are very useless.
Very lazy.
Yes.
While it was fascinating to see how communities are trying to adapt to the impacts of climate change, it got me thinking about the bigger solutions needed. Ethna put me in touch with Clever Kanga, who works for the Foundation for Irrigation and Sustainable Development. He believes two things are vital for Malawi's future: irrigation and solar power.
Solar power can be used for agriculture. Solar power can be used for house heating and lighting. Solar power is really a sustainable way for Malawi to go.
Clever brought us to a school just outside Lilongwe, where they have an irrigation system that's powered by solar panels. The project enables the school to grow food on its land, which is used to feed the pupils. The solar energy powers a pump, which draws water from deep underground into a reservoir. From there, they can channel the water into fields to irrigate their crops. It's such a simple but effective system. The project has literally transformed the school, helping to grow its attendance from around 400 to just under 800. It's incredible when you think about it. Not only is solar power providing a clean and sustainable way to irrigate land and feed children, it is also helping to ensure access to education. Here, the sun is doing more than powering equipment. It's powering lives.
There has to be the political will. There has to be policies that look into promoting of solar-powered systems in Africa.
Clever's point about the need for political will really struck me. That's the case whether it's Malawi or Ireland. We absolutely need the political will and infrastructure to push forward a transition to renewable energy. And in Malawi, like Ireland, there is an urgent need for climate change activists willing to challenge the power of governments and vested interests like the fossil fuel industry. I was interested to hear from Heather and others about their own climate activism.
Having a platform as a young person, my social media platform, my friendships, university platform, I decided to use those platforms to advocate for small changes that I could in my university and outside of my university. I've been involved in district campaigns at the local level in my district, and also have been involved later on in national campaigns at national level, mainly being proactive with young people, as some of the campaigns include calling for good policies with government, and the small campaigns include stopping the cutting down of trees unnecessarily.
Heather put me in touch with members of a new climate justice group at the University of Agriculture and Natural Resources in Lilongwe.
We are planning to do more activities, since most of the people outside there, they don't know the causes of this climate change, they only know the impact, so we need to build the capacity to create awareness so that they should know the causes.
Very worryingly, climate and environmental activists in Malawi face a significant battle against oil exploration in Lake Malawi. In February 2016, the government of Malawi lifted a ban on oil exploration and drilling in the lake, which is an area of immense environmental, cultural and economic significance to Malawians. I asked the students what they thought of oil exploration in Lake Malawi.
Personally, in my opinion, I thought I disagree with the production of fossil fuels. Some people say, okay, if we extract fuel from Lake Malawi, we're going to boost the economy. But to me, as a student who knows about the stuff, will say, no, it won't be okay. Because the impact which we're going to have after that will not be okay.
Oil drilling in Malawi has not been supported by the general public and I myself as an activist, because we are aware of some of the impacts that oil drilling has on an ecosystem and on a lake system as Malawi. Lake Malawi supports a majority of populations in Malawi that are living along the lake, be it in terms of transport on the lake, be it in terms of fishing. And with climate change issues or environmental degradation, there's a high dependence on the lake by these communities. Oil spills have been common in many places where oil drilling is taking place, and it has greatly affected the ecosystems of that area.
When I asked Juliana Lunguzi, a member of parliament, she doubted whether local people would benefit financially from oil exploration.
I'm worried to say, should we have the oil? Are we going to benefit? Because we are looking at experiences from neighboring countries, other countries, where there have been oil, there have been war. So I'm thinking, are we starting war? I don't want to think like that, but the more people are not opening up about the whole oil exploration, the more I think that there will be shadow deals, and the local people, especially people from the East, which is a very rural area, won't benefit. So I'm skeptical.
There are people who are dying because of climate change. And to have governments or individuals invest in the very causes of climate change that is causing other people to die, I think that is a very huge injustice. For me as an activist and for the communities of Malawi, it would only be fair or a just system if those countries could consider their decisions and be more thoughtful of what they're doing, not only for selfish reasons, but also for the global good, and to be able to say that our actions have for a long time been affecting countries that are not responsible for climate change.
Heather hits the nail on the head about the complete injustice of climate change. Those who have done least to cause climate change are suffering the most because of its impacts. Developed nations bear most responsibility for causing climate change. In December 2015, an historic global deal on climate change was agreed in Paris. But there was not one mention of fossil fuels in the entire agreement, despite the fact that 60% of global carbon emissions come from our dependency on fossil fuels. Expert analysis has shown that to have any chance of avoiding runaway climate change, 80% of fossil fuel reserves need to remain unburned.
The one line the world has ever drawn is this line that says we're going to try and keep temperature increases below 2 degrees. Well, if we follow the business plan of the fossil fuel industry, we will go way past that. There's no doubt about it. There's no mystery about it. There's no drama about it. If they do what they have told shareholders, banks, others they will do, then the planet will break. And that's why we've said, just as 25 or 30 years ago when the issue was apartheid in South Africa, that's why we've said this is one of these cases where it is necessary to break links with these companies in order to put the most pressure on them that's possible, to turn them into the pariahs that they must become.
The fossil fuel divestment movement sends a strong message that fossil fuels have no future. It's actually the fastest growing divestment movement in history. More than 500 institutions with a value of 3.4 trillion have already committed to divest from fossil fuels. At the launch of Trócaire's fossil fuel divestment campaign, I spoke with Ellen Dorsey of the Wallace Global Fund, a major player in the fossil fuel divestment movement in the US.
I think any government that has public funds either invested in the industry or is contributing directly through fossil fuel subsidies is complicit then in the climate impacts.
But what about the Irish government? Ireland has an extremely high level of emissions for our population size and is currently way off track for meeting commitments to reduce them. To make things worse, the Irish government is investing public money in the fossil fuel industry. Approximately 72 million of Irish taxpayers' money has been invested in some of the most controversial and polluting fossil fuel companies in recent years. I met with Deirdre Duff from Fossil Free TCD at Trinity College Dublin.
To be honest, it makes me really angry that the Irish government could be using taxpayers' money to invest in the industry, probably the most dangerous, corrupt industry on this planet, and to fund climate change. It's completely wrong. It also is completely contradictory to a signing up to the Paris Agreement and saying, yeah, we want to tackle climate change.
We needed a powerful grassroots constituency to take on the climate issue and to take on the fossil fuel industry. And this student-fired movement has broken open the climate debate in ways that I think none of us could even have anticipated, that broke it open for investment managers and the financial sector, has taken it not way beyond their universities to faith groups, to pension funds, to cities, and to my sector, philanthropy.
Last summer, so summer of 2015, we lodged an FOI Freedom of Information request to see if Trinity had investments in fossil fuel companies. And that revealed that they had over 6 million invested in fossil fuel companies, coal, oil, gas companies. Universities are kind of meant to be leaders in society and leaders in the educating of future generations. So if they divest, it kind of sends a powerful signal that, look, this money, that the fossil fuel companies' money, it's toxic. It's not something that you want to be investing in. And I think students, I suppose in the past, in Trinity's sake, students would have put a lot of pressure on the College Board to divest from South African apartheid, and they did divest. So there is that precedent.
Colm Duffy, a PhD student, has been one of the drivers of the fossil fuel divestment movement in NUI Galway. His research in Malawi has left him in no doubt about the urgent need to move away from our reliance on fossil fuels.
I would have been in Malawi for 6 or 7 months working with the World Agroforestry Centre on an agroforestry impact study. And we would have seen farmers firsthand, and we would have seen drought firsthand, and we would have seen crop failure firsthand. You know, I suppose at first it was kind of my own interest as to go, I wonder, do they have any investments? And quite a lot of universities do. So I'd made a few inquiries and submitted a Freedom of Information request, and it turns out that they did.
Currently, NUI Galway has at least 3.4 million euros invested in oil and gas shares globally.
We, I suppose, thought it was a little bit maybe hypocritical to be, on the one hand, say that, yep, we're a global leader in climate change mitigation, and on the other hand, be directly financially supporting fossil fuel companies.
Many other universities around the world have divested from dirty industries, and NUIG should follow their lead.
I met with Ben Chrisman at Queen's University Belfast to hear about the Fossil Free QUB campaign.
The Fossil Free QUB campaign has been going for around about 18 months. And once we found out where Queen's invests its money, we carried out a number of actions.
Queen's ignored the soft campaigning tactics of our group when we started. So for basically the first year, and we wanted, Queen's is about £5.5 million of public money invested in big oil through its endowment funds and all the rest of it. They ignored soft campaigning tactics of our open letters, staff and alumni support, public meetings, student referenda and pickets, Queen's specific academic reports. They rejected our Freedom of Information request to access the investment data. It took us 10 months to get a hold of that, and it was damning when we got it. So backed by what we saw anyway as the indisputable moral legitimacy of what we were trying to do, we adopted a direct action approach at Queen's University to force the issue and demand that the attention that it deserves. We occupied a QUB Senate meeting initially. This was the same group as the people that run the university. We also, the following week, staged a sit down outside the Planning and Finance Committee and blocked the doors. Instantly, we felt a surge in support, both online and in our active membership. With visible success in our direct action approach, we decided to up the ante. On the 11th of December, we occupied the finance office.
how many of us, 13 of us I think, snuck our way into the admin building on up to the second floor and buried ourselves in a corner of that floor.
The issue of climate change and fossil fuel divestment was on every 6 o'clock news bulletin, trended on Twitter without interruption, and on the front page of many national papers.
Disappointingly, despite their high profile campaign, the university has yet to commit to divest from fossil fuels.
If Queen's decides against divestment, then I think the obvious route for Fossil Free QB will be to re-escalate our campaign, because the issue of climate change isn't going away.
Such inaction from Queen's University reflects a broader lack of climate ambition in the north of Ireland, in particular among the political establishment.
I think it would be fair to say Northern Ireland is not a leader in terms of climate change. Certainly, if you look at the rest of the UK and the Republic of Ireland, I think Northern Ireland is probably the part of these islands that is lagging behind.
In contrast to the Republic, Northern Ireland doesn't even have a climate change law. If QUB ever did decide to divest from fossil fuels, not only would it be far-reaching for the university and its students, it may also help to put pressure on political leaders in the north to turn the tide towards greater climate action.
There's two risks to not divesting from fossil fuels. The one is to your own investment portfolio, and that is these companies, their stocks are massively overvalued, they're holding reserves that can never be burned, and so it's a risky investment. We're already seeing now that being invested in the fossil fuels is damaging to your portfolio. So from a financial perspective, from a fiduciary perspective, it's important to get out of fossil fuels now. I think the other risk is truly an ethical one. We cannot divorce ourselves from our investments. If we own fossil fuels, we own climate change, and we're responsible for the effects.
Back in Malawi, I was interested to know what people thought about developed nations' reliance on fossil fuels and the international fossil-free campaign.
I think it's time that the developed countries start to work on cleaner energy, you know, forms of energy that are environmentally friendly, sustainable, long-term, and more greener in nature. That would be better, because it will ensure that it safeguards the way of life for the present generation and the generations that are to come in the near future.
I think divestment campaigns are quite good for countries that are not following a carbon neutral pathway in their development, especially the northern countries. I believe that this is a very good way of them actually being proactive or being able to address climate change issues, not only for their countries, but also for countries like Malawi. It is gaining momentum in the northern globe, and I think we're quite happy with the work that our fellow activists in the northern side of the globe are doing.
I would love if you can go in the field, if you can go in the streets and advocate that climate change is really there, and climate change has really impacted us as African countries.
Yes.
So if you can help us to advocate and tell your government that we're really facing problems here of climate change.
Our grandparents are really suffering here. They do not have food. We are suffering from floods each and every year.
The burning question to the Irish people and to the Irish government is, what will you do to address the causes of climate change that you have already contributed to? What are the investments that you will do to rectify the situation? And what are you going to do to consider countries or developing countries that are facing the impacts of climate change?
Heather's words summed up a lot of what I had seen in Malawi. It is the poorest people on earth who are paying the price for how the richer people live their lives. That's the injustice of climate change, and we have to do what we can to tackle that injustice. The climate change that is destroying crops and emptying riverbeds all over Malawi is being driven by the fossil fuel industry, an industry that the Irish government continues to invest public money in. Now is the time to ask the burning question: how are our financial investments fueling climate change? And now is the time to make our money part of the solution, not the problem. Until we do that, we are investing in our own destruction.